the band.
All right, we're into the draft, ladies and gentlemen, for game number three of our first semifinals for North America between Gangstars and Immortals. Whichever team wins this game will move forward to the finals. Let's find out who's going to be.
Koshka would also make a lot of sense as a first ban for a team like Gangstars here, because, again, you don't want to ban the Adagio or Lyra. You can guarantee yourself one of those two picks by banning away the Koshka. Immortals have to answer it. They don't get to pick it in one of their two picks.
Especially when we've been critical on Aloha's performance on many different heroes, or the other heroes that he's been playing.
Well, they're going to take the jewel away.
D'Anzio did have a pretty impressive performance, as you mentioned before, Humanist, day one. So perhaps that's still weighing on their minds.
Well, again, unless Immortals plans on first picking this Koshka, it's definitely, you know, they can still ban it away on the second rotation. I think that would be really wise of Gangstars to do.
Immortals taking a little bit of time on their answer here, not just jumping at the chance to ban away Lyra. So they're definitely thinking, okay, what happens if we ban something else? They take Lyra, we take Adagio. They're going to ban Lance.
And this should be an incredibly easy Lyra pickup.
You said you like this Humanist, but Bacon says it's an easy Lyra pickup. What makes you like it?
Because they're going to get one of these power picks. And before, when the Lyra was there, they were drafting a comp that was running at Gangstars. Like, that's all they were going to do. So Immortals can take a little bit more of a balanced approach, and they'll have the Adagio in their lineup. It's just going to be a lot stronger, if that's the case.
And if you're running into a team composition with Adagio, there's a Verse of Judgment potential there, right? So, you know, if you take the Lyra and go for something similar, it might not work out so well.
Probably not. You're playing against Immortals. No, I'm teasing. I poke at Gangstars. I do love these guys. It's going to be Lyra. No surprise there. They burned a little bit of bonus time, though.
Yeah, I'm surprised they used any time at all. Like, I'm surprised that even 5 seconds
ticked
off that ban.
You know what that time was? It was like Araki, Zoro, and Rekt being like, no, I want to play it. No, I want to play it. No, I want to play it.
Or maybe it was just both of them just being like, wait, they left it open? Like, really? Really, guys? That's
they're
something
like
that
already
they just
down
did?
The line.
Yeah. They didn't realize it wasn't banned. No.
That could be the case, but I doubt it. I think they're just playing it smart. Immortals, they're going to pick up the Adagio.
We thought that might happen. Adagio pickup.
What is the ban going to be, though?
I don't think the Glaive was too scary coming out of Gangstars. That's not something you need to worry about.
I
could actually be something they look to pick up.
Again, Kestrel could make sense here. Just make sure Xenotech can't play that.
I like that.
But then we're maybe looking at Samuel, right?
Yep.
Samuel, Lyra, very strong combination. Mm-hmm. Also something Xenotech plays.
I mean, you have to pick your poison. I just think Xeno's Kestrel looked stronger than his Samuel. He looked really strong.
I agree. I think Gangstars has really shown up at the beginning of the season. Obviously, whether they make it to the finals today or not is going to be quite telling about how good they are, how consistent they are. If they do make it to the finals and they face Team Solo Mid again, for example, it'd be pretty interesting as a rematch. Very, very much the opposite of Europe. Immortals, they're using a lot of their bonus time on this ban, though. Obviously, a very important game for both of these teams.
Ban out the Ringo? There's not going to be, especially if D'Anzio does take the Adagio to lane, there's not going to be many laners that are going to stack up against him, and he does very well into the Vox.
I would actually be okay with Immortals banning either the Ringo or the Vox here. But they are going to take away the Kestrel.
That's fine.
That's what I was kind of thinking. I was leaning towards that being the ban. If I was in their shoes, that's what I would have done as well. And now Gangstars, like, I feel like their biggest choices are, do we take away the Koshka? Do we take away the Vox?
Koshka.
Do we take away the Ringo?
You take away Koshka, I think. I mean, it's 100% win rate.
I think you should
over
take away Koshka.
Games.
You should
That's
take away
ridiculous.
Koshka.
That's
but
just a fluke. If I've ever heard fluke statistics, 10 in a row.
But I'm also wondering, do now Gangstars leave the Koshka open because they have Lyra?
No.
No.
I really think that's a terrible idea.
I think they should ban it.
I see where you're coming from. But
I don't think
numbers,
it's a good idea.
Come on,
but
numbers.
I think that could just be their mindset. Is we have Lyra, we can let Koshka go through. But they are going to ban it away.
My bigger question is, like, can Immortals maybe run Samuel? Can they deny another pick from Gangstars? Does it make sense here? You know, I feel like it could work.
I actually do typically like Samuel into Lyra because a lot of times teams want to go ahead and clump up on that sigil as they're healing up.
Oh, yeah.
And then you can just, that's when your Drifting Dark Malice verdict comes out.
Even if, Oblivion sometimes.
Yeah. If Immortals pick up Samuel, I actually really want to see Gangstars grab the alpha for Xenotech.
Dang. I like that a lot. I think that makes a great deal of sense.
So, because, I mean, again, what's Samuel's biggest strength? Kiting backwards through a fight. What's Alpha's biggest strength? staying on you no matter how hard you're trying to kite.
Right. I mean, if that's the case, though, they're going to have to worry about Verse coming out at any point. Sadajo can just hold his ground. Ooh, Fortress action, huh?
I don't like the Fortress into the Lyra as much as I like it the other way around. But this is Immortals. I mean, they play a lot of Fortress.
I just hope, I really hope that Fortress ends up on Vayne's and not on Aloha, because I really do not feel like Aloha had any sort of impact in game number one with it.
So the question is this Captain Adagio with a jungle Fortress or Captain Fortress with a lane Adagio?
Or jungle.
Hopefully.
Or jungle. I would hope not with Zio on the. I'd like to see it in Zio's hands, honestly.
You know what I would like for a last pick from Immortals?
Okay.
Weapon Power Arden.
Oh my god.
This is a comp that it works really well in. The Lyra can be harsh. But without Kestrel being on the other side.
Yo, chat can be harsh. You're about to find out.
But without having... You have Kestrel banned away. Kestrel is also very strong against the Weapon Power Arden. Lyra can be very strong against it. But...
Until you're proven
Adagio
right...
Adagio and Fortress are so good.
Until you're proven right, every time you start talking about Weapon Arden, I'm going to start talking about some other ridiculous thing that's not going
to I believe
out.
It's innocent until proven guilty. So until I'm proven wrong...
Not in draft. Not
Weapon
in
Power
war.
Is legitimate.
I don't know about that. Vox coming through with the Lyra. That's obviously a very strong combination. What are Gangstars going to round it out with? I think they need a captain because of this weapon power Lyra.
So for me, this means I would like to see Adagio go to the lane. Just as far as
you
that
outrange the Vox.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very well. Yeah. And we know that there's going to be pressure up in that lane. Just curious.
Gangstars.
3 seconds left. Black they grab feather. The Black Feather. All the more reason for a Weapon Power Arden.
All the more reason?
All the
just
more reason.
Just to steamroll him early?
You can destroy a Black Feather in the jungle with Weapon Power Arden.
What's your build path?
You start off, just go straight for a Sorrow Blade.
Mm-hmm.
Get some boots along the way, perhaps. Get him to tier 2. Well, it's if you, depending on when you have like shop timings, if you have enough for your Sorrow Blade, just go straight into Sorrow Blade. If you have enough... to get your tier 2 boots.
So let's get to the interesting bit, because obviously when you play Arden as weapon power, you have to buy a Sar Blade because you don't have any inherent weapon power.
Exactly.
So what's the interest? How do you make it work, as opposed to make up for the fact that you're coming from behind?
You're not coming from behind. That's the thing. You have so much damage. But this is the other pick. We were saying we wanted to see Immortals pull out, take Sky, put it on Aloha, let him make some plays.
I mean, honestly...
But is this going to be him? I mean, is this going to be...
D'Anzio is also a very good Sky.
Right. And then we legit don't know if this is a Captain Adagio or Fortress.
We'll find out.
What would you prefer?
I would heavily prefer Aloha on the Sky with D'Anzio in the lane and the Fortress on Vayne's as Captain.
I think I would also. You don't want to have all your damage on the Immortals composition beyond the two heroes that have dashes into a Lyra.
I don't want to see Weapon Sky out of the jungle, though. She's just going to be behind. Like, sure, you got levels... Do some damage now. Anytime now.
I would be fine with double crystal here.
Really?
Okay. I am not normally it's okay with double crystal.
It's actually a comp with a lot of damage output. Mm-hmm. If there's a few that I would be okay with this, but I don't know. Then I think you're not really taking advantage of the fortress necessarily.
I also think that against a Lyra when you go double crystal, your damage doesn't continue to like ramp almost infinitely with breaking point. So past a certain point, I feel like her sustain matches you, and she can navigate around and stop you from dealing damage.
Maybe.
I just feel like if you're going Crystal Sky, the damage from Forward Barrage just out damages the healing from a Sigil, and so you can't just stand in a Sigil getting your healing.
You're assuming, though, that you're going to land all that Forward Barrage.
If they're standing in a Sigil, you should be hitting your entire Forward
Barrage. I'm assuming Sky goes to lane.
I have a feeling that's what they're going to do. I don't like it. Mostly because I feel like Fortress does not give Aloha the opportunity to be the playmaker that we know he is.
Well, there's a lot of different ways this could go. Let's have a look. It is going to be D'Anzio on Sky. So, knowing that, who do you favor coming into game number 3 to go to the finals?
I'm going with Gangstars.
Well, this is a tough one. Ooh, this is a tough one. I'm going to go with Gangstars too.
All right. Well, both you guys thinking Gangstars can make it to the finals 2 weekends in a row. Obviously, Immortals desperately need those points. In comparison, they're right down at the bottom of the standings still with only three right now, I believe. So they've got a lot of room to grow this weekend. Let's see if they can as we head on to the Halcyon Fold one more time with Jaws and Four Court Jester.
Oh, man. Game number three, Immortals versus Gangsters. My name is George, joined by Four Court, as always. And, wow, game number three, we've got a Sky, a brand new pick coming into this best of three, and a Fortress as well from Aloha.
Yeah, well, it's going to be a little bit more the Captain Aloha this round. Vayne's on that Adagio, very likely to be going a little bit more offensive on this one. But double Crystal, even triple Crystal, there's nobody here that could realistically rock Weapon unless it's going to be D'Enzio. And he does start off with the Weapon Blade. We'll have to see if he continues into that.
Oh, wrecked. Is he going to steal it away? Who got it? Didn't see. It was Aloha. He did steal away the other Treant as well, just to let you know. So did get a little bit of that jungle back from Immortals. But yeah, you're not wrong. I mean, will Dizzy Enzio go the weapon power? I mean, I've always been a fan of the CP Sky, at least. There's a lot of damage just up front. It's very nice for that kind of burst. And we obviously do have Vayne's on the Adagio as well. Are they going to put all the eggs in D'Enzio's basket? We'll have to wait and see.
Well, the other then trick question here is that Xenotech is just finding himself in the wrong neighborhood here.
Black Feather.
That's going to be first blood. The other big thing here, Jaws, that Arakizuru has gone into a crystal bit. We could see a CP Vox here, and that means it's going to be a weapon Black Feather.
Whew, that would be quite interesting, actually. So CP Vox has an absolute ton of damage over the AoE, so definitely something to fear. Aloha and Vayne's are going to be here. He's going to prance away. No worries. And Immortals taking the early lead here. Obviously, that kill, and it will go over to Aloha as well. So that's going to be really nice of him in the jungle. And he's just going to leave D'Enzio up in the lane. He's got no problems, really. I mean, we spoke a little bit about before how Wrecked, obviously, on the Lyra can just be so, so offensive, just using the poke potential, obviously, the healing as well. And Arakizuru as well, kind of known for his Vox play, can be quite difficult to deal with in lane. But D'Enzio, he seems to be holding his own.
Yeah, so far it's all pretty honky-dory. I mean, Xenotech going down definitely wasn't what they wanted. Aloha's looking to just contest his jungle, but Xeno did get the
yet
train.
Again, Xeno is going to be in the opposite side jungle. Immortals just kind of collapsing on him here, but that does mean Gangstars are going to be in there as well. Xenotech, he is by the turret now. We'll take a couple of hits. Aloha's going to dive in. The turret isn't going to aggro him for a moment longer, and he will be able to escape with his life, surprisingly.
Ring around the Rosie. That's all you got to play. Aloha's going to intercept him here, but Wreck, he's already throwing down the preemptive heals. That will help Xeno, especially if he picks up the Treant, to get back into fighting form. But Wrecky and Wreck able to help cover. No problem. D'Enzio, yeah, he went for a bit of a walk, but now he is going to be back up in lane. And still, 22, 25, the lane hits going back and forth pretty consistently. There's no big imminent threat this time for D'Enzio to really worry about. I mean, he was the first blood last round to that roaming Wreck Glaive that kind of came in just with the afterburns, but he doesn't really have to worry about that. So how much lane freezing we're going to see, it's probably going to be significantly lower than what we just saw in the previous game.
Yeah, most definitely. And with that, and we do see the first buys coming in, and we will see what we're facing here. And D'Enzio, yep, he's going for weapon power on the Sky. You weren't wrong. And it does look like Arakizuru is going for the crystal bit build as well. The crystal build as well. So that will be a weapon power Black Feather. Now, speak to me about this weapon power Black Feather pick, because I think this is the first time we've actually seen a weapon power Black Feather. Correct me if I'm wrong, but we've already seen him CP quite a few times.
I've been on the EU side, I've been on the NA side. I've definitely seen both Black Feathers, but I can't really remember if he was constrained to one region or not here, Jaws. But we have seen it here at this split. Ultimately, it's definitely a little bit more dangerous when it comes to that weapon, because he's really going to be relying on just sticking to you, getting that damage done. The Serpent's Mask is going to be coming in. It can work.
Whew. Yeah, Wreck taking a little bit of damage there. We'll see if it can work. Obviously, yeah, like you said, Serpent's Mask will probably be coming in very, very shortly. Immortals going on the aggression. Xenotech is going to be here as well. It's like they telegraphed it somehow. They knew Xenotech was going to back off at that point. But Gangstars just consistently on the offensive here. using Xenotech to just kind of zone off, and that will be really it. Vayne's obviously on the support of Adagio, the captain Adagio. Mm. Now, obviously, he's not going to be too strong in the sense if he was a laner, for example, going the CP or the weapon build, obviously, but he's going to provide so much sustain like the Lyra. And again, we are seeing a pick ban in terms of Adagio and Lyra. It's pretty insane that these two heroes are just so hotly contested right now.
Well, ban one was Lance. You can't give that to Rekt. You can't give it to Xeno. You can't really give it to anybody on Gangstars. And ban one on the flip side was Jewel. I mean, Jewel's been definitely making some waves. In fact, I would have actually wanted to see a Jewel last game instead of that Rhyme. But that aside, you know, the Jewel has really been becoming a threat. The NA gods yesterday of TSM, you know, really kind of showing how this side of the ocean deals with it.
Yeah, this side of the pond. Your side of the pond, it's not us.
Still with NA yet. Between us, bro.
Yeah. That's very true. Very true. Not wrong. Oh, Arakizora. He's just face checking there. He's going to be a little bit careful. Aloha's going fairly deep under the turret. Arakizora's going to be able to trade up a little bit of that damage. That's going to be it from that. Immortals just consistently on the aggression now. They're really just paying back Gangstars for game number one, where they really just got punished over and over again by the composition of Gangstars. And they're going in yet again. The Bright Bulwark does go down. Attack at the back as well, but that's going to be a quick trade. One for one at this current time. Aloha's going to have to get out of there. Vayne's is going to have to run as well. Not too much damage on their front right now. That's the Black Feather coming through for you. Vayne's the last one alive, and that could just be a complete triple kill, a complete ace going over to Gangstars, where it looked Immortals were completely on top of that one, just following up on Gangstars.
Xenotech able to rinse repeat, basically. Everybody already in range room. The on points are going to be very hard to miss at that range, and that execute status when he has that feint ready to go. It closes the gap and gets off some pretty major damage, especially when you're down at low like that. So they trade out the laners, not a problem, but Xeno really showing why the weapon of Black Feather needs to be kind of respected at this point. Picking up the kill, picking up the turret, now very likely to pick up the rest into that Serpent's Mask. And from here, you don't even really need to get too much more offensive. Like, the Black Feather is going to need to tank up, especially if Danzo wants to try to dance around him. You're going to have to deal with Aloha and his puppies. Very likely big armor to come out.
Well, speaking of Aloha and his puppies, Aloha is going to jump straight in on Xenotech, but Xenotech doesn't seem to really care at this point. Death and Baruff comes down, doesn't really do much of anything. D'Angelo was falling here, and there comes the Verge of Judgment again, not really doing much whatsoever. Blackfeather going huge. He's going to pick up another kill there, as well as Vayne's falling at the end. Arakizora is probably going to pick up this kill. He does indeed. Ace coming through from Gangstars. Two aces in 2 minutes coming through for Gangstars. They want revenge for game number two.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, like, Xenotech's really getting good positioning on this. He's the focus target. You saw how healthy Araki and Rekt are at the end of that fountain, plus the Serpent's Mask. Now, on top of that, a Shiver Steel. Good luck. If Xenotech gets on your face, you are not running away very easily onto this one. And that's something that, you know, Sky is really going to have trouble dealing with. Yeah, he might be weapon, but really the only repositioning here with this is going to be that Suri strike. And Vayne's, you know, no innate escapes, really just has to try to power through it. Aloha kind of is going to be the big deterrent up against Xenotech because he has that Stormcrown, he has that Aftershock. But as well, at the same time, right, all the damage landing top of Xeno, who is going to be bulking up, that's leaving Arakizora just a wide open field to get all these crystal bounces and these big fights up against that crystal Vox. He's having a heyday.
He really is, and anybody that's trapped in a tight corridor like they've been fighting around, oddly enough, is just going to get pretty much deleted. Arakizora doing an absolutely fantastic job so far, but Xenotech really leading the pack here for Gangstars. He's 4-2 right now on this weapon power Black Feather. And yet again, Gangstars, as soon as they seem to get a lead, they just seem to just punish Immortals for even just touching their own jungle. Crystal Sentry will fall as well. That's going to be the first one of the game. Two lives remaining for the Immortal side, and that is going to be it for that. Gangstars, yet again, just asserting control over Immortals.
Big thing is that first pick Lyra, right? It could have been Adagio, it could have been anybody else, but Rekt getting this Lyra, they have huge confidence in the fact that Rhett can actually just control the game almost from minute one. You know, how many times have we seen these sustains coming through? The clutch escapes. He's now going to be looking after that. There's no Stormcrown here, by the way, right? There was no big aggression jungle, right? He does go into the fountain. So, Bacon, just keep an eye on that one, bro. But he does fountain into the War Treads. Now he's going to be looking for very likely that Crucible on top of things. So, he's patched up mobility. We have a lot of room to maneuver here from Gankstars. And again, like the front line, if it's not Xenotech, it's wrecked. Araki Zoro, though, is virtually untouched in these last two fights.
He really was. And with that damage as well coming out from him, but Time Immortals do get the chance to actually kind of, you know, jump on him. He's already done enough damage for to kind of push Immortals out of the fight, or at least get a kill even some of the time. D'Enzio is just falling kind of flat on his mech every single time, and not really able to do anything in the fights whatsoever. I mean, we've seen the last two times. He comes in, he does use Death from Above, but Gankstars, like you said, they've got that mobility, and they are able to do something about it. D'Enzio's off to the side here, though. Attack of the Pack is going to come out. Bright Bulwark as well. Death from Above comes out once more. Doesn't really hit anything, and now the re-engage comes through from Gankstars. They can jump on D'Enzio. D'Enzio was almost going to fall. There he goes. Ends up going down. Vayne's is the next on the menu. Double kill through for Xenotech. Rekt's going to chase off Aloha here. They're actually going to split their resources now, with Araki Zero going to the lane to try and finish off that turret. And Rekt and Xeno are finally going to find the kill on Aloha eventually. But what another fantastic fight from Gankstars.
Whoa! Was that enough? Oh, that was just enough. Aloha stopped out the ace.
Oof. Okay, yeah. I didn't think that was actually going to happen, but wow, okay.
It was like game of milliseconds right there. But turret down. Now they're going to be down to Aloha for a little bit. This is a free gold miner in every sense of the word. And there's not really an answer to this Black Feather so far. It's Immortals just trying to find these picks. Like, D'Enzio might have wanted to lead off with the Death from Above that last fight. He kind of just got on an auto attack off and repositioned over to his teammate. Like, the sandwich didn't really feel good. And then, you know, the Death from Above came out real late, and they were already clear of it by then. I think he really did miss out a big tool right there to kind of control the fight. But at the same time, there's nothing to stop Xenotech, right? He's getting this damage. He jumps into the back. He's building up that armor. He is tanking up. He has another infusion to go with it here. D'Enzio bought a level 8 infusion, really didn't want to use it until 9, but couldn't get the experience. So he popped it there at 8 for that fight. Didn't get anything out of it. Unfortunate for him. But Xeno has no counter at this point, right? He's bulking up. He's going to stay on top of D'Enzio, and really, there's nothing to stop him at this round.
Yeah, well, you saw him in that fight just at the back line. Just couldn't really do much else. Vayne's is going to get jumped on again by Gankstars. There comes the Verse. Doesn't really do much. He drops like a ton of bricks. Now, D'Enzio's going to go down as well. Xenotech just going so aggressive on this Black Feather, and he can really at this point. 8-2, not something you want to see, especially on a weapon power Black Feather. My goodness, he is only just carrying this game on his own like he did first game. Xenotech just coming out as the rising star for Gankstars.
I really do think, again, like last game was a big draft win for Immortals. They're able to play it out and execute very nicely, which got us into the game 3. But when it comes to the draft this round, I mean, Rhett getting Lyra and then no answer to this Black Feather. It's I just haven't seen Sky, I think, win at all in VG8.
It's really been hit or miss, I think, with Sky a lot of the times. I don't think we've seen a weapon power Sky do very well. I think we've seen one crystal power. Again, correct me if I'm wrong, but yeah, I mean, it's so easy to kind of avoid the Death from Above's half the time, unless you're like ridiculously unprepared and you do
Sky
get hit on the back
one
line.
Win.
And...
One win in NA right now. One out of now 4.
Not a good one, right? And that might be 1 out of 5 as well after this match. We'll have to wait and see.
This match makes 4. If D'Enzio can't win,
right,
it will be 1 out of 4. And it's a pretty slippery slope. 6,000 gold at the 13 minutes is nothing to sneeze at here.
Definitely not. And Gankstars, they're trying to get a bit of vision down now. Rekt pushing forward. He can do. He has got passage available if he really needs it. Probably won't, however, because the sheer aggression from Xenotech and Araki Zoro will be able to follow up. He's actually just going to bait out D'Enzio there just a little bit. He knows what he's doing. And with that, Gankstars are going to push up this wave.
Less than a minute for the Kraken. Gold Miner is probably the big priority. I mean, the last little big hurrah. And Gankstars, they're coming down. Look for the infusions. There they are. Tier 3 armor on Araki Zoro. Not that he's been feeling the pressure at all. But even if he does kind of come down to the wire, he has his bases covered.
Yes, indeed. Three offensive items, plus obviously that one defensive item picked up now. He's going to be dealing a ton of damage and taking very little from D'Enzio. I mean, D'Enzio has got breaking point and he's got the monocle, but he's just... It just seems like he's not even staying in the fight long enough from for that breaking point to actually stack up. And it doesn't like Gangstars are going to be able to take that gold mine pretty much uncontested. Baines is going to get jumped on here by Gangstars yet again. Now they're targeting D'Enzio. Xenotech just switching targets on the fly here. There comes Death from above. Not really doing much again. Yeah. The attack of the pack does get come out though. But here's Xenotech. He's on the back line. D'Enzio trying to kite back. And actually, he's doing something at this point. Xenotech almost goes down. But Aloha in the front lines was just alive for so, so long until Black Feather arrived. And now D'Enzio is coming up big with a kill. But yet again, Xenotech on the forward lines does manage to pick up the kill. And that's going to be it. Gangstars, they are absolutely running Immortals through the ringer right now.
Now, Rek just saying, don't worry, I got this. I mean, it's only going to be 13 seconds to a racking comeback. Xenotech is going to be looking to push out with the wave here. It has a few seconds of unfettered access, and the choke is going to drop. Make no doubt about that one. It's an easy pickup as Rex. Again, like, Rex's not going to kill this, but he's at least keeping it engaged. It's reducing the amount of work that's going to be needed later. And I will give Immortals credit. I thought that that engage definitely went a little bit better for them because Aloha was on the back line. He was on top of Araki Zoro. That's how they got that kill. But Xenotech's just not on the same plane, really. Like, the pressure is just not syncing up because we had him on top of Xeno. We had Aloha on top of Araki. Xeno, like, what, one bar health? No problem. Still gets the ace and lives on through. It's, I don't know. Like, D'Enzio just doesn't seem to be really super comfortable on this guy. The synergies are not adding up.
Not at all. And we did mention, obviously, before, the death from above just never seemed to actually land at all.
Aimed?
I mean,
yeah,
it seems like in that fight, he was just trying to protect himself and Veins, just using it on himself in that sense to kind of make sure Xenotech can't get on top of him. But Xenotech was like, that's fine. She's that there. I'll just jump on someone else. No worries. I'll jump on Aloha, who's actually like in amongst our fight, in amongst the rest of my team even. And that was really it. I mean, after that, D'Enzio, yeah, like I mentioned before, couldn't really get the breaking point stacks up, couldn't deal meaningful enough damage, did get a kill at the end. But again, Gangstar's coming out on top, and with that turret down, they're just going to push into the base here. Immortals just looking a little ruined at this point. Aloha is going to get jumped on once more. D'Enzio as well, just trying to kite around here. They can just force Gangstars into a little fight, but so can Gangstars. There comes Death from Above, actually stops up. Wreck this time. Burst of Judgment is going to come out. It's going to get blocked. However, Aloha is going to have to back off of this fight. He's low at this point, but D'Enzio, you've got to look at him. He's actually doing meaningful damage in this fight, but no, not anymore. Xenotech comes through pretty big, and that's going to be it. Immortals just with a rather unconvincing game number three, is yet again Gangstars just take control and they take game three and the series.
There's too many threats on the board with this team. Like, Gangstars have, you know, Xenotech, the all-star jungle, they got Araki Zoro in the all-star lane, and then Wrecked, who has continuously just really proven that he can play a lot of these different roams. His glaive definitely fell flat with the captain in game number two, but Lyra, if you let her through the draft, that's a pickup from these guys. They don't care about no Adagio. As long as Wrecked has a Lyra, the control of the game just went right into their pocket, because he was able to just, again, masterfully do a lot of the early game shutdowns. He was able to facilitate a lot of the kills. The sustain goes pretty much unmatched, and it's enough to get them into finals. We'll have to see what they can do for the more points here a little bit later on.
Yeah, congratulations to them. And with that, that will be Gangstars going through. And I think we'll jump straight over to the desk. There's a lot to talk about in those three games, especially this last one, with Gangstars really just showing up to the plate. AJ and the boys, take it away.
Thank you very much, guys. All right, Gangstars making it to the finals 2 weeks in a row. Very strong showing from them. Immortals, they did take one game off of them, though. I do think they've offered, you know, quite a different view of them from last week, at the very least. Excited to see what happens in the third place.